And I'm back to do the UFC 158 predictions video. This event is going on in Montreal in Canada. Not surprisingly, considering who the main event is. Yes, it's Georges St-Pierre once again. Georges is fighting Nick Diaz. Why? Well, who knows? I mean, this is a fight that has been on and then off and then on and then off for as long as I care to remember, at least 2 or 3 years. and that's about all there is to be said, to be honest. You know, lots and lots of smack talking from Nick Diaz. Lots and lots, no doubt, of promises from GSP. What do we expect? Well, we expect a decision victory for GSP. As per usual, I think we've got to face facts that he's not likely to change his modus operandi, and no matter who he fights. So, you know, once this fight is out of the way, at least they'll then be able to get back to GSP fighting who he should, because this is a bit of an exhibition match. This, rather than a, you know, nothing Nick Diaz has done has qualified him for this match. That's just one of the things that the UFC are doing to create a big gate. A look out for the first fight. This is Ruben Duran. He is fighting Georges Roop. Georges Roop in a dangerous position, considering the UFC and their policies on cutting. Loss, win, loss, loss is his record. Cub Swanson, Hatsu Hoki and Mark Hominick are the losses. Oh dear. And he's fighting Ruben Duran, who, whilst he doesn't have quite as good a record, Georges Roop is 12-9, Ruben is 8-4. Ruben should win this. One of Georges Roop's issues is submissions, and that is one of the specialities of Ruben Duran. He is not so much on dangerous ground. Win-loss is his recent record, but one of those losses was a split decision to Takaya Mizugaki. I expect this to be a Ruben Duran choke submission in the second. Right, Isai Tamura is fighting TJ Dillashaw. Tamura is decision master. TJ Dillashaw, you know, he's actually a lot better, I reckon. not a lot between them. 7-3 for Tamura, 6-1 for Dillashaw. I'm going to go for a TKO for Dillashaw in the third. Quinn Mulhern is a Strikeforce import who is about to fight Rick Story. His main area of strength, it should be noted, is submissions. 11 out of his 18 victories are by that method. However, most of the people that he has submitted are no names. Rick Story, on the other hand, his area of strength again was submissions until he started to win decisions. He is a frustrating person for me because he's fought the same level of competition for, oh, how many years? At least 3. And he was doing really, really well. And then suddenly he started losing. And his recent record, win, loss, loss, win, loss. Oh dear. He's now going to be in danger of being cut. I don't think he'll get submitted, but I have a feeling that this will end up being a Rick Story decision. If any match gets the chance going, it will be this one. This is going to be a stand-up war between an American and a Canadian. The American is Darren Cruikshank with a record of 12-2. He's on a 6 fight win streak. And he's fighting John McDessie, who is 10-2. So there's not a lot between them. The other thing, of course, is that they both are stand-up fighters. Unfortunately for John McDessie, those two losses on his record are incorporated into his last three fights. I think this one, unfortunately, for the Canadians, is likely to go to Darren Cruikshank. I am going to say I think it'll be a TKO in probably the first. The hypocrisy of the UFC never ceases to amaze me. But this is Jordan Mine, who was in Strikeforce, but then left Strikeforce, and yet somehow has managed to be incorporated, one presumes, in the Strikeforce imports into the UFC. It's like everybody that's had anything to do with Strikeforce is automatically UFC. Anyway, Jordan Mine, 26-8, so he's got quite a record. And he has faced some decent opponents in his time. Although most of those he has won by decision. He is mainly a striker, but also rather good at submissions. And he is going up against Dan Miller. It also should be said that this is another Canadian versus American here. Dan Miller, one of the Miller brothers. His area of expertise again is submissions. This could well be underdog of the night, but I am going to go for Jordan Mine, and I think I might go for him by TKO in the second. I would like to see a Darren Elkins win with the fight between him and Antonio Carvalho. Not much between them on records, 15-5 for Antonio, 15-2 for Darren. But I would also like to see something other than a decision win. So I'm going to go hopefully for a TKO victory in the third. But if not, I am reasonably confident that he'll win by decision. Bobby Volker, 24-8, a Strikeforce Challengers fighter who has spent maybe the last, I don't know, 2 or 3 years fighting one person, Roger Bowling. You will be happy to know that he managed to win the best out of three there. he is fighting Patrick Cote, 18-8, an absolute mainstay for the Canadian draw. And although Volker's got 15 out of 24 wins by TKO, I think Patrick Cote and his experience level will pull him through here. And I'm going to go for a Patrick Cote decision. Colin Fletcher is one of the lucky Brits not to have been purged. Although why, when he's only had one fight in the UFC so far and he's failed there, is anybody's guess. But here we are. He has another chance, and I assume he's going to go for submission, considering 7 out of 8 of his wins are that way. He's facing Mike Ritchie, who is a Canadian stand-up fighter usually, but I can't say that his record is, much good. So I think that Colin Fletcher stands a chance here. So I'm going to go for a bar submission in the second, merely because it would be nice to have some British people in the UFC, outside of the British people that I don't support, of course. I think it's a bit of a toss-up who will win between Chris Camozzi and Nick Ring. 18-5 for Camozzi, 13-1 for Nick. I'm going to go for Nick Ring because he does know his submission game, and that is a big, big standout for the weaknesses in Chris Camozzi. So I'm going to go for a Nick Ring bar submission in the second. This is striker versus submission artist, and this is Jake Ellenberger 28-6 against Nathan Marcourt 32-11. Nathan is back from Strikeforce. He has in fact only fought once a year since 2010. And I do feel that if he wants to get a win here, he must submit Jake Ellenberger, and I don't think that he will be able to do that. I really don't. His weakness is decisions. So I think it will either be... I think it'll be a Jake Ellenberger decision, but I do hope, some of me hopes, that you know he can get a TKO in the third or something. And finally, Carlos Condit is fighting Johnny Hendricks, and you know I haven't got a clue who's going to win this one at all. Johnny Hendricks has never been finished, but Carlos Condit does tend to finish people. I think that the interesting thing about Johnny Hendricks here is he's probably got the ground game to neutralise Carlos's stand-up. And yet he's got a good stand-up game as well. In the end, that might just end up cancelling it out. I'm going to go for a Johnny Hendricks decision.